And welcome to Greenville United Methodist Church. We are so glad to have you with us. If you're watching with us today, we ask that you please comment or like to let us know that you are there. It's important that we keep this interaction going. We just don't want you just to watch. We want you to participate in this worship service. Hopefully here soon we'll get to see each other again in this sanctuary. We really do miss having everybody here, but right now, because of circumstances, we can't be in the sanctuary together, but hopefully here soon, one day, we'll be back together, and we can't wait for that. A couple of quick announcements before we get started. First of all, the Mountain Mission will be here tomorrow to pick up all of our goods, and so you have one last chance come in the morning to drop your stuff off before the Mountain Mission takes it away. Also, something I'm very proud of, our youth group has shopped for 20 children from the local family resource center, Angel Trees. That's 20 kids that are going, yeah, good. That's 20 kids that are going to get to have Christmas this year because of our youth. And we're just so proud of that. Now, there's still a need out there. So if you feel so led and you would like to help provide Christmas for a child in our community, you can contact one of our local family resource centers at the schools and call and say, I would like to help sponsor a child. They would love to have you do that. And so if you feel led to do that, please make that donation. Our call to worship today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verse 31 to 35. When he had left, Jesus said, Now the Son of Man is seen for who he is, and God seen for who he is in him. The moment God is seen in him, God's glory will be on display. And glorifying him, he himself is glorified, glory all around. Children, I am with you for only a short time longer. You are going to look high and low for me, but just as I told the Jews, I'm telling you, where I go, you are not able to come. Let me give you a new command. Love one another. In the same way I loved you, you love one another. And this is how everyone will recognize that you are my disciples, when they see the love you have for each other. Amen. Amen. At this time, we are so blessed to have Trey and Hallie to come and to light our Advent wreath for us.
Today we relight the candle of hope. Now we light the candle for the second Sunday in Advent. This is the candle of peace. As we prepare for the coming of Jesus, we remember that Jesus is our hope and our peace. From the prophet Isaiah, for a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9, 6 through 7.
Also from the Gospel of John, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. John 14, 27.
Lighting the second candle reminds us of the complexity of what it means to feel peace this year, with the year full of uncertainty, anxiety, and fear. The peace candle invites us into a safe and secure space where we can just be.
As we light the candle of peace, we acknowledge the times this year when peace is felt too far away. We acknowledge the times when our peace is felt insecure. We acknowledge our shared desire for your safe presence of peace as we continue in our Advent journey.
Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for the gift of peace that is found in Jesus Christ. Remind us of the safety and security of your peace as we enter into another week. Amen.
Good morning, church. We certainly do miss your presence here. Would you join us as we sing together, Angels from the Realms of Glory?
That's too great.
Oh,
Before we say our creed, I want to tell you, last night I had a chance to put up some Christmas lights, and as I was putting them up, I had to get the ladder out. And this ladder, I mean, I'll tell you what I know about this ladder, okay? This ladder has supported me in good times and bad times. 20 pounds ago, it supported me good. 15 pounds ago, it held me tight. 10 pounds ago, it was a little shaky, but it got me through. So last night, when I got on this, and I'm trying to climb up a tree with this ladder, I had to focus on, what do I believe about this ladder? Will this ladder support me? Is this ladder strong enough to get me through this difficult time? And when I considered all the evidence, and even the little shakiness, I had to put my trust and say, on this foundation of this ladder, I will place my weight. And I got to hang some Christmas lights. And I say that because when you go through times like this, like COVID and all the craziness we see, you got to have a foundation. If you don't have a foundation of your beliefs, of what you are standing on, then you're going to be washed around left and right. You got to have what you believe solid. And that's one of the reasons why every Sunday we say this creed. It's not so we can just memorize it and say it over and over and over again. It's because we need to be reminded these are the truths that we hold dear. That when everything else is falling apart around us, these truths are unchanging. And this is what our faith is built on. So would you say this Apostles' Creed with us together? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to prepare our hearts to go, Lord, in prayer. And a name we want to add to our prayer list and be in prayer for is Vina Raleigh. She is going to begin her chemo treatment this Thursday at Vanderbilt. And so with all the craziness going on, she's going to be having to travel back and forth each week there until February when she has her operation. So please keep her in your prayers. Also, we're glad to say that Dick came home this past week. And so, was he still as grumpy as ever?
Grumpier
than ever. So we're glad. I'm glad about that. And so, continue to keep Dick and his family in your prayers. Let's now prepare our hearts to the Lord in prayer at this time. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, Lord, how great and holy you are. You are a wonderful Lord. You have blessed us in so many ways, and so we want to say thank you. Lord, I thank you for your goodness to us. Lord, I thank you for this church. Lord, just today thinking about just all the stuff we've done over this holiday season, Lord. We put together close to 100 boxes to pass out for the Christmas child. We have fed close to 800 people for Thanksgiving, and now our youth giving Christmas to 20 kids, Lord, that's just so wonderful. And Lord, I thank you for the heart that you've given to the people in this church. I thank you that you've allowed us to be the church that seeks to help others and to be the hands and feet of Christ in this world. Lord, you've called us to go out, to make a difference, to share the good news, the word and deed. And Father, we want to be the church that does that. We want to be the church that is not ashamed of the gospel, that we boldly proclaim, this is who Jesus is. This is what Jesus has done for us. And this is how we live because of what he has done. So Lord, I thank you. I thank you for all the saints who have sat in these pews and all the lives that have been impacted. And Lord, I pray that you continue to do so. And Father, we want to lift up the names on our prayer list for all those right now who are hurting. We pray for those right now who are battling not only illnesses, but Lord, those who are battling loneliness. It's hard to be cooped up all by yourself and not have the fellowship that you're so accustomed to. Father, I pray that even though we can't physically be together, that they would know that we still love them and their church cares for them deeply. While we pray for those right now who are battling this terrible virus, we pray for those who are battling all kinds of illnesses, and pray for your healing, because we do believe you work miracles. And so, Lord, we thank you for your power, we thank you for your love and your grace, and we thank you for all you do for us. So it's with that confidence that we now say together the prayer that our Savior taught us to say as we say as one, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
We are fortunate to have a return engagement of Charity and the Praise Team this morning. So if you would join us as we sing together 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship your holy name. worship your holy name. Worship your holy name.
Amen. All right, I want to ask if you could have all the children gather around the television sets, and we're going to have our children's moment, and we're so glad to have all the kids with us this morning. So I want to say, first of all, welcome to Emily, to Allie, to Parker, of course, Cam, and Maddox, and Skylar, and Alana, Tatum, Atticus, Virginia, Austin, all of our friends. We're so glad to have you with us this morning. And I want to tell you a Christmas story about experience I had. And I want you to know, first of all, sometimes Christmas doesn't always go the way you think it's going to go. Sometimes bad things happen, but you can't let the bad things ruin your Christmas experience. Okay? I'm going to tell you a story about a Christmas I had when I was close to your age. I lived in Radcliffe, Kentucky. And that time, my dad wasn't employed, and so we didn't have a lot of money. And it was a really tough time, but my uncles had come to stay with us on Christmas. And so my Uncle Kenny, who had Down syndrome, was staying with us. And my Uncle Gilbert, we called him Uncle Bull because he was a big man, he was staying with us too. Now that night, we had all gathered together to have our family Christmas. And we ate Grandma's cooking and we had punch and all the good stuff. Now that night, on Christmas Eve, we were real excited because Santa Claus was going to come and see us. And because my uncle was staying with us, my brother, my sister, and I all slept in my sister's big bed together because we were all together, all excited. Now, we had a rule in our house. My dad had this rule. It was very important. No one could go see what Santa Claus brought until the morning. If you went before then, Santa would come and take a gift away. And so we didn't want that to happen. And so we're all lying awake at night. We're all so excited. And then my brother, Larry, gets up and he starts to run out of the place. And we're like, no, my sister jumps up and says, no, Larry, you can't go. And Larry's got his hand over his mouth like this. And Pehm and Larry are fighting right there in front of the door because my sister's trying to stop him from going out. Well, what Pehm didn't know is that Larry was going to get sick. And so all of a sudden, Larry goes, bah! And it just goes everywhere. And my sister sees this, and so guess what she does? Bah! It goes everywhere. Well, the commotion wakes up my Uncle Kenny, who comes out of his bed, and he has a weak belly, and so when he sees what's going on, guess what he does? And of course, no one stands still and does it. Everybody's trying to get to the bathroom, so both bedrooms are covered in this. The hallway is covered. And everybody's just got a big mess, and it was just terrible. My poor mom and dad got up, and they're like, what in the world is happening here? What happened is, that was the Christmas we all had the flu. And everybody was sick, and we felt terrible. And that, you could say, was one of the worst Christmases that I would ever have. But you know what? It was actually one of the best Christmases I ever had. That was a Christmas I remember that my dad sat down and played with my wrestling figures with me and got me some wonderful things. It was one I remember, one of the most memorable Christmases, even though we were so sick. It reminds me how, like, the first Christmas, you know, Mary and Joseph, things were hard for them. It wasn't easy. They had to go from Nazareth to Bethlehem on a donkey. Can you believe that? And then when they got there, they couldn't find any room in the motel, so they had to go and deliver a baby in a barn. And Mary didn't have her mom with her, her dad, or no one like that. And so you could say, wow, that was hard. That was a terrible experience. But when Mary held baby Jesus, she says, this is the best Christmas ever. Now, I know Christmas is going to be different for a lot of us this year. But you know what? We can't let our circumstances change the joy that this brings. Christmas is about Jesus Christ being given to us. And so no matter what is taking place in your life right now, no matter how hard it is, even if you have the flu and going bleh everywhere, Christmas is still a time of joy. You can have that joy, even though things aren't exactly the way you want. Okay? Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, I thank you so much that nothing can take away the joy of Christmas. Not sickness, not isolation, nothing whatsoever can take away the joy that Christmas brings to us, because Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, and he was given to us on Christmas. So Lord, bless these children. May they always have that joy of Christmas, and remind them that how much you love them and how much we love them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank y'all.
We welcome Kim to sing for us this morning. She'll be singing a song by Lauren Daigle called Noel.
A child is born, he shall reign forevermore. Noel, Noel, come and see what God has done.
Thank you, Kim. That was beautiful. If you have your Bibles, take it and turn to the Gospel of Matthew. We're going to be reading about Joseph today, and I always feel bad for Joseph. You know, Joseph is, whenever there's, you know, a pregnancy, they always ask, well, how's the baby and how's the mom? No one ever says about the dad. You know, Joseph is like that forgotten character in the biblical story. And in fact, you know, Joseph is, he doesn't have any speaking parts. One of the sad things about this story is that Joseph never has a speaking part. And so everybody wants to play Mary, no one wants to play Joseph. But Joseph plays a key role in the story. So let's look together at Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant with the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. You know, in life, there will be times when you'll have to make decisions. And these will be difficult decisions. Now, sometimes choices are easy. Sometimes you got to make a decision about, okay, what are we going to have for lunch today? And that's easy. But sometimes those decisions are difficult because you have to deal with the pain and the hurt that someone has caused you. And you have to think of the needs and concerns of other people ahead of your own. And so how do you make those decisions? Now, sometimes the easy answer is, well, pick up the Bible and find out what it says. And sometimes that works. And, you know, we are really good about when we have an emotion or we know what we want to do, we will look and look and look until we find a Bible verse that matches what we already want to do. You know, we are very good about using the Bible to justify how we feel and how we respond. But you got to be careful because there's a lot of things in the Bible that don't necessarily have the heart of God. You know, there's a part in there where it says, you know, David prays, smash your children's heads on the rocks. And you're like, you know what? I'm mad. God, I picked the Bible verse, smash their heads on the rocks. You're like, God's like, that's not how it's supposed to be used. But we are so good about doing that. But sometimes what we do misses the heart of God. I had a professor of mine, his name was Dr. Knickerbocker, which I always thought was one of the coolest names ever. But he told a story in class when he had a friend of his who had a foster kid in his class. In his family. And the foster kid had been just a wreck. And he had come in and he had caused so much heartache and so much misery to their family. And when he left, he had burned so many bridges, he had hurt so many people, that they were just like, good riddance, get out of here. But about 5 years later, this young man called the family and said, I'm broke, I'm homeless, I need help. Can I come back to live with y'all? And he was no longer just a kid anymore, now he was in his 20s. And he went to Dr. Knickerbocker and explained just how angry he was and how dare this young man, after all that he did, come and try to put himself back into our family as if nothing ever happened. And Dr. Knickerbocker said, you know, I understand how you feel. You have every right in the world to be mad. And you are justified if you say, don't ever come back here again. And the guy said, yeah, that's right. Because when he left, I said, you know, you will reap what you sow. That's in the Bible. He says, you're right. And you have every right to act that way. But I think you and I both know what the right thing to do is. And he said, I think you need to do what's right. And he just left it at that. And I love how he did that, because he said, do the right thing. Not the easy thing, not the thing that justifies how you feel emotionally, the thing that's at that moment feels like the best thing, but the thing that is right. And that's when you take everything you know, what the Bible says, what you know about Jesus, what you know about the heart of God, what you think is best for that person, and what is best for you. And you take everything you know, and you make the best choice you can make at that moment. That's not always easy, but that's hard. And that best choice is the one that best exhibits a biblical witness, a heart that is touched by God, a life that demonstrates the grace that Jesus Christ has changed, and one that glorifies God the most. And that's why I've always been intrigued by the story of Joseph, just because of the choice that he had to make, and he had to make the right decision. Now, I want to focus on Joseph pre-dream, okay? Because the decision he makes pre-dream is the decision I think is the most important choice. Now, once the angel shows up in your dream and says, Mary, Mary, that's settled, you know? When the angel shows up, you do what the angel says. Easy peasy, you know, that's easy. But before the angel shows up, Joseph had to deal with this terrible decision. What do I do with Mary? This girl who says she is pregnant by God's child, and I don't buy that story. But how do I make the decision what to do with her that is best for her, that best glorifies God? And how do I do that when at the same time I feel hurt, betrayed, and dishonored? That's tough. And that's where Joseph found himself. So if you have your scriptures, go back to Matthew chapter 1. We're going to start with verse 18. Just like last week, we're going to walk through the story and see how this Christmas story plays out. So I want you to see, first of all, the pain of Joseph. So it says in verse 18, this is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. Now, like we said last week, we kind of tend to read that like we would in a modern-day society, you know, like boy meets girl, girl meets boy, boy and girl fall in love, they live happily ever after. That's not how marriages worked back then. The way that marriages worked was that basically there was three stages. The first was the arrangement stage. And that was where the two families would get together, either the groom or the groom's family and the family of the bride, and they would work out the deal. Okay, how much would you give me if we do this? And they try to do what is best. And so they always said that marriage was so special you couldn't leave it to just chance. And so part of me kind of likes that, so I can pick the guys that my daughters will marry, you know. So, but this was a thing, and so what they would do is they would discuss, okay, how much will you pay me for my daughter? And how much, I mean, what do you expect to get from my daughter? And then, how much do I have to pay you to marry her? That's called a dad dowry, which I always thought was a funny thing because, I mean, what kind of statements that say? Hey, here's my daughter. I will pay you to get rid of her. You know, take her. How much will it cost to get her off my hands? And so that was one of the things they worked out. But remember, this is from the Bible. When Jacob went to go marry Rachel, Laban said, okay, you can have her if you work 7 years for me. And so they worked out this deal. Okay, there's always this thing. So that was the first thing. Also came with that was what was known as bride price. And that was what came with the bride. What was her inheritance? What was the property she had? What things did she bring to the marriage with her? And so when she got married, all that became property of the husband at that time. So that was all arranged, and that was the first stage. Then when it came of age, the second stage was the betrothal. And we don't really have anything like this in our society, but basically what this was like you were already married, but you couldn't be together. And so in all practical purposes, you were already married. And if the spouse died, you were considered a widowed. And if there was, the only way to break it was by a divorce. And so there this time what would happen is that the groom would say, I take you to be my lawfully wedded wife and do all that good stuff. And then he would go and get the house ready and get everything done, everything said. Normally this lasts about a year. And so, but in that time, they were married, but they didn't get together. And so there really was no contact between the two. And so that's why, like, when Mary finds out she's pregnant, she doesn't just rush over and tell Joseph. She goes and spends with her time with Elizabeth. And what's sad about that, that means that Joseph probably found out about Mary's pregnancy from someone else, from secondhand source. And so the last stage was the marriage proper. That was when the bridegroom would return, and then he would bring his gang with him. They'd have a week-long party, and it was a big celebration. The whole community got involved, and it was where everybody was so excited. But that point, Joseph, before that, it says he found out that Mary already was with child. Now, I don't know how you would feel about that. I would be upset. I would be furious if I was engaged to be married and all of a sudden my fiance shows up and she's got a belly, not caused by tacos. And she says, and what would make me even more if I said, how could you do this to me? And she dare bring God into it? Oh my goodness, I would be furious. I would be so mad. But let me ask you this. How do you typically respond when someone hurts you? How do you respond when someone upsets you, when someone humiliates you, when someone disrespects you? How do you respond to that? I'll tell you what our natural response is to try to get even. I mean, we want to hurt people who hurt us, especially if it's someone very close to us, someone who's hurt us bad. I had to Google this past week, so I was like, okay, give me some stories of people who got revenge on cheating spouses. And I want to see how this worked. And so I have no idea who Graham Norton is, okay, but on the show called Graham Norton, they had a story about this. And there was this groom who found out that his fiance had been cheating on him. And so he didn't break off the marriage. Instead, what he did is he had the wedding celebration, and they had the big wedding reception, and then he got up to speak. And he said, all right, everybody, I want everybody to turn over your dinner plates. And if you have a red dot underneath your plate, stand up. I have a surprise for you. And so people look under their plates, and eight men had red dots. And all the eight men stood up and were looking around. And he says, everybody, I want you to see, these are the eight men my wife cheated on me when we were engaged, and I am now going to go get an annulment. And he walked out. I was like, man. But you know, there's a part of us like, ha ha, stick it to her. That's what she gets, you know? And we do that. Think about it. When people get divorces, they want to make sure I got the best lawyer, because you hurt me, I'm going to make you pay. I'm going to make you, I get every dollar I'm owed, and I'm going to make sure that you suffer for what you did, and I want everybody to know what a piece of trash you are. So let's say that if you went through that, someone hurt you, and then you had a chance to publicly disgrace that person to kill their reputation, would you? I mean, most of us would do it. Hey, all we have to do is look at Facebook. I mean, goodness. People get on Facebook and air all their dirty laundry to make sure you know that this person did this. But imagine if you could take the Bible and justify your response. What if you could take the Bible and say, I have the right to do this? And remember, Joseph did. Book of Deuteronomy, Numbers, Leviticus, they all said, if your spouse cheats on you, they are punishable by death. Now, in those days, the Romans wouldn't allow them to kill anyone, though you could get away with it if you did it real fast. But you could kill the reputation. You can kill so many things about them. But he could say, look, the Bible says I have the right to do this, and he could use all that to make sure that they all got what's coming for them. And plus, remember, adultery. Of all the sins in Israel, adultery is considered to be one of the top three. Adultery, murder, idolatry. Those were the things that they viewed most. And this was a national issue. Remember, the Romans were in charge, and the Jewish people thought that the reason the Romans were there is they were being punished by God for their sinfulness. So anytime someone sinned, they were like, "Ha, you're the reason we're suffering like this." And so Joseph, when he found out about all this, he had a choice to make. And look, so look at verse 19. It says, "Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man," or faithful to the law, "and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly." Now here, Joseph had three options, and none of them are easy. The first option was just to go ahead and go along with the marriage. You know what? Yeah, she cheated on me, but I don't want to break this. I don't want to ruin this. But if he did that, they would still get married, but there would be consequences. First of all, people can do math, okay? If all of a sudden Mary's pregnant before the date and the baby shows up a week after the wedding, you're like, whoa, something's not right here. And plus, they would look at Joseph and say, "Ha-ha, you're the guy who could not wait." Or worse, "You're not man enough to stand up to your wife who cheated on you. And now you're just the coward." And so they would always be viewed through dishonor and disrespect. Now the second thing was that he could divorce her publicly. And this is where he would publicly disgrace Mary. He would bring her out and say, "Everybody, I want everyone to know, everybody know right here, right now, this woman has been unfaithful to me." And make sure everybody knew that it had nothing to do with Joseph, it had all to do with Mary, and so there would be all the dishonor and all the shame would be placed on Mary and upon Mary's family. Not only that, with that being done, the family would have to return the dowry. I mean, we would let him keep the dowry, and then Joseph would get to keep Mary's bride price. So all the things she was going to inherit and all that would then be given to Joseph. He would keep all that. And plus, he got to publicly embarrass the one who hurt him. I mean, think about that. Wouldn't that be great? Not only did he get all the blessings of the marriage, but then you got to get rid of her and make her suffer? I mean, that's what the world would want, right? The third option, which was very seldom ever done, was to divorce privately. And that would be the way that would bring shame and dishonor on Joseph. People would look and say, "Joseph, Mary's a good girl. How could you do that to her?" Joseph would have to say, "I don't want to talk about it. But Joseph, you're a rotten man." And then Joseph would have to pay back the bride price. The family would get to keep the dowry. And so then he would have to pay the divorce settlement too. And plus, he's the one that would walk around with his head hung down and people looking at him through shame. Now, of all these three options, we are told that the one that Joseph chose was to divorce Mary privately. Now, why would he do that? Now, remember, this is all pre-dream. We know that he did not believe his story, I mean, her story. And we know that he was acting out of a place of hurt and grief. And plus, he could have said, "The Bible says, stone her, kill her, get revenge." But yet, he said, "No, I'm going to divorce her quietly." And the Bible says he's a righteous man, faithful to the law for this. Why? Because he did more than just keep the law. He knew more than just what the Bible said. He knew the heart of God. You know, so sometimes people can know exactly what the Bible says and still be the meanest people in the world. Sometimes the people can get the Bible and use it as a weapon. There are people who look at the Bible and don't necessarily have the heart of God. You know what we call them? Pharisees. But Joseph said, "I know what the Bible says, but I don't want Mary to be hurt. I don't want Mary to go through that. Even though she hurt me, I will bear her sin. I will bear her grief. I will bear the dishonor in the community so that she would be free from that. I will bear all of this." but she wouldn't have to. Now notice that he just didn't dismiss it. He doesn't say, Mary, it's okay what you did, because love equals accountability. He was still going to divorce her. But he did it in a way where Mary wouldn't suffer the shame and the pain. And that says a whole lot about him. We can't disregard just how hard this was for Joseph. He knew the law, but in knowing the law, he acted out of love and chose to show grace. Now, the angel steps in gratefully because it's been awful he went through this. But in verse 20, it says, after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save the people from their sins. So all of a sudden, the angel will confirm Mary. So now, notice something. First of all, the angel does not condemn Joseph, saying, Joseph, how dare you? You were going to divorce Mary? Didn't you believe Mary? He doesn't say that. He says, Joseph, don't be afraid to do this. He confirmed that Mary was telling the truth. Now, understand that after Joseph married Mary, it still wasn't easy. First of all, Joseph still had to bear dishonor and shame. So much that, you know, we learn forever years that people still did not consider Joseph to be the father of Jesus. That people still said that Jesus was either dad was unknown or dad without a picture. And then Joseph was then going to have to take a secondary role. Like I say, he has no speaking parts. But you know, one of the things that we always read the story and we don't think it hurts too much. But remember when Jesus was 12 years old and he had gone off and he came back and they couldn't find out where he was. They're looking around the caravan like, and Mary goes, Jesus! No. And they couldn't find Jesus, so they had to go back to the temple and found that he was there with the teacher of the law. Do y'all remember when they asked where he was, what he was doing, what his response was? Jesus said to Joseph and Mary, did you not know I had to be in my father's house? Now, Joseph, you're not really my dad. What that must have done to Joseph to be reminded of that. So what does this mean for us? Well, first of all, it means this. Knowing what the Bible says needs to be combined with knowing the heart of God. We need to be more like Jesus and less like a Pharisee. Paul says this in 2 Corinthians 3:6. He says, the letter of the law kills, but the Spirit gives life. The letter of the law kills. In other words, if you are mad, you can find a verse in here to justify what you want to do. I remember one time I heard someone say the Bible said that it told him that he could marry 8 women. I say, 8 women, it doesn't say that. He says it's right there, 4 better, 4 worse. Okay. Oh, come on, y'all got to laugh at that. But sometimes we can pick and choose a verse and say, that verse is the one that I'm going to use to go after you. But here's a couple things. We kind of forget that sometimes we got to see the whole story. I remember sometimes, for example, y'all remember the story of the book of Job? The book of Job, Joseph's suffering, Joseph's friends come and try to tell Job, this is why this is happening to you. 3/4 of what the book of Job is Job's friends talking. But do y'all remember what happens at the end of the book of Job? God shows up and says, you guys are wrong. And so if you're just going to pick a chapter and verse in the book of Job, there's a good chance that verse is wrong because God says it's wrong at the end. That's why you read the whole story and get the whole thing and learn the heart of God. Y'all remember Jesus when the Pharisees brought a woman who was caught in the very act of adultery and threw her at his feet and says, the law of Moses says that a woman like this should be stoned. What do you say? Remember what Jesus did? Wrote in the sand. And finally, let him who was without sin cast the first stone. And then he didn't just say, it's okay. He said, now you, where are your accusers? And he says, go leave your life of sin. He didn't say it was okay, but he says, leave it, but I'm not going to condemn you. He balanced truth and grace. And that's what we need to do. Second of all, when you are heard by others, respond through faith and not through rage. Think of what's the best thing that you would want to do. See, we forget. Sometimes we're going to mess up. And Jesus says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If you were in that position, how would you want that person to treat you? You'd want grace. You'd want love. You'd want mercy. And finally, to make a decision, you have to take everything you know, including the Bible, the heart of Jesus, tradition, reason, all these things, and do what you believe is best. I'll tell you an experience I had, and I'll close with this a little bit. The first church I served, I had a girl come up to me in the community, and she had been involved in a terrible marriage. The husband was verbally abusive, controlling, domineering, and finally she got up the courage to leave, and then she met this guy, got married, and had a kid with him. Well, then all of a sudden, her old minister comes up and says, "What you've done is wrong. You left that man, and he did not commit adultery, so your divorce was not valid." Even though he was abusive and all that, you know, in his eyes, that was okay. "And so what you need to do is divorce this man, go back to your first husband, and then God will bless you. If not, God will smite your children to the fourth generation." And so she came to me and says, "I don't want God to hurt my kids. What do I do?" Now, the thing is, that pastor, he had the chapter and verse. This is what it said. My response was simple. What do you think Jesus would tell you to do? I said, "Does this sound like Jesus?" She was like, "No." I was like, "Well, then you have the answer. You take all the information you have and you do what is best." And I love Joseph about this. Now, it's amazing that you always hear the saying, like father, like son. But it's amazing how Joseph, in his decision on how to treat Mary while he was hurt, to bear her sin, to bear her guilt, to bear her shame, it wasn't like father, like son. It was like son, like father. And that's how God's called us to be. Be the church that offers grace and mercy to those who hurt us, to those who disrespect us, those who call us grief. That he calls us to be like Christ. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly and gracious Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the grace that's been given to us in Jesus Christ. And Lord, there are times when people will hurt us. Sometimes it's a misunderstanding. Sometimes it's just cruelness. But Father, in how we respond, may we just decide to respond through a heart of grace and mercy. Help us to be like Christ in all we say and do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you join us as we sing our closing hymn this morning, "What Child Is This?"
A child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthem sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and aid.
I want to remind everybody that the Mountain Mission truck will be here tomorrow, so if you come early in the morning, you can drop off stuff, your last chance to do so. Also, if you would like to help sponsor a child for Christmas, again, contact the family resource. It's called a school, John? Okay. Any of the schools. It's called schools. And so we are grateful for Kim for singing, for Charity and the praise band, and for Patrick and all the hard work, and Chris. And so thank you all so much. Let's bow our heads and be dismissed. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, as we leave this place, may we go forth knowing that we have been touched by your love and touched by your grace. Let us go forth and share that with everyone. Lord, may when people know us, when they see us, when they come in contact with us, they will know that we are a life that has been touched by Jesus Christ. And may they see you living in us and through us. Now, Lord, bless us and keep us safe now and forevermore. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.